Cowboy fan in the world. Biggest Cowboy fan. He wore a fedora hat because he loved Tom Landry so much, and we would sit and watch games all the time. And he would always promise me, he would always promise me, well, one day I'm gonna make enough money, I'm gonna take you to one of them games. Of course, he never made enough money. We never got to go to a game, and then when I transferred, I couldn't play my junior year, so he would always promise that he's going to be there my senior year. He was proud of me for making the decision to get ready for college. And then I lost it. He passed 3 days before that. And he always would say to me, boy, if you just keep working hard, one day you will play for the Cowboys. And April 24th, 1988, when they called my name, my God, man, it was the most incredible moment, honestly, in my life. I graduated. Back then, you had to graduate to leave early. I graduated after my junior year of eligibility, so it gave me a little bit of control over the draft. Green Bay called with the 7th pick. And if you're a junior, I could drop a class and go back to school, and they would lose their draft pick. I can apply for a supplemental draft. So get this now, I'm 1 of 17. I'm the 15th of 17 kids. I mean, we were poor, so poor. I know it's poor, but we were too poor. We couldn't afford another one arm. We just said poor, right? When Green Bay called with 7, I said, no way, Green Bay. I can't go there. In Dallas, when they picked me at 11, my house erupted, man. I was born to play for the Cowboys, and it ended up that way.
Yes, sir. He was born to play for the Cowboys. So, now I have two, I guess, Cowboy questions for you. First one, so you drafted in 1988.
Yeah.
They gave you the number, number 88. Which more did you feel pressure on? To live up to the number 88, or the simple fact that you was drafted in 88 and you were number 88?
The first person I met coming off the airplane in that April 24th in 88 was Drew Pearson. He was there at the airport. He ended in his interview with me, and I love Drew. Drew's my guy right now.
Yes, sir.
We've become very close, and this is before I knew they would have given me the number 88. And Drew, in all the questions he asked me, is, you know who the leading receiver Cowboys is? I said, absolutely, I know Drew, you know. He said, yeah, I'm glad you know. I said, Drew, I also know who it better be in about 10 years, or they'll run me out of town. You know what I'm saying? I didn't know they were going to give me that number. And to be honest with you, I had so much reverence and respect and love for Drew, because I always say I measure a man in distance travel. You know, and Drew would be undrafted and do what he did. I just thought the world of him. And I'm like, I don't want that number. I wore 47 in college. Give me 7 or give me 4. Like, I don't want 88. I don't want that pressure. But they gave it to me. And it's the greatest thing in the world to be linked to him that way.
Yes, sir. So you drafted, you meet Drew Pearson, you get an 88. So now we got Irvin going to Irvin. How did that feel?
Wow.
How did that feel?
It was incredible. And my best friend in the world is Mitch Richmond. Mitch Richmond is a Hall of Famer in the NBA, right? And you know, we went to school together, and, you know, stole each other's girlfriends in high school, and did all that, got grown in high school, everything, best friends. And he got drafted number 5, the Golden State. I got drafted 11 to the Dallas Cowboys. And he came to visit. It's so funny when he said it. And I picked him up in this little BMW M3 I had bought him. I thought I was the man. I picked him up in his car, and we were flying from the airport right in Irving. And he said, hey, man, what's wrong? Man, you driving like this, man. Stop. You freaking crazy? You stop. And then we stopped in the red light. I said, why are you talking like that? I said, look up. And it was that big water thing with Irving on. I said, you see what that is? That's Irving. You're in my city. Wake up. And I took back off. So it was incredible to have the last day and to actually be playing right there and to see the Irving at the time.
That's incredible. That's cool. So, alright, boom. We in Irving. You and Mitch pulled up. You got your pass, you got your helmet, it's game time. Take me through that first NFL touchdown.
I want you to understand this. We were playing, I remember playing Pittsburgh Steelers. And Ken Norton, I was the first round pick, Ken Norton the second round pick. Ted Tram had just made a statement. Everybody said, well, why Tom Andrews drafting this crazy guy from Miami? I had jewelry on, I had on this big old rope, like a hook cap around my, this big old rope. And Ted Tram, he should accelerate our return to the living. On draft day, and they showed this picture during the draft, and I just cringed. Get that off, I got a cane going on, with the rope, kicked that off, and said, Cowboys on their way to the Super Bowl next year, I'm here now. I lost maybe 3 games total in my 3 years playing in Miami. And we got to Pittsburgh, I ran a curl route on Rod Woodson. Touchdown. I said, oh, this is NFL stuff, it's easy. And then they scored, and they scored again. And they scored again and again. And we lost 13 games that year. 13 games. I'm like, oh my God, what am I getting into? It was incredible because we were not that good. We were not that good. And Ken Norton and I used to sit back like, man, we were boo-hoo crying at all the games that we lost. But we knew we had a start to building something, and fortunately, we started drafting some pretty good guys.
Cool. So, I'm gonna ask you this question. You can tell this story, you can't tell the story, so on you. So, during Super Bowl 28, I read, that you snuck out of the locker room at halftime to go watch Michael Jackson perform it. Is that true or not? And if it is, can you take us through it?
Well, Super Bowl halftimes are long. Much longer than the regular halftimes, right? And this is Michael Jackson. Let's be real here, people. This is Michael Jackson. So we're going over everything, and Coach actually gives us, you got it, Coach. So you got to say, he said, I'm going to put some things on the board. I said, all right, I'm going to run to the bathroom. He was writing on the board, and Michael Jackson was out there performing. I went to the bathroom, I went right by that bathroom, I walked outside, and I watched the show. And I came back. Coach, what's up? Well, what took you so long? I said, Coach, I had the number 2. I watched Michael Jackson, man. There was no way I was going to miss that, man. It was an incredible, incredible show. And he puts on an incredible show. What a blessed gift he was to all of us all of those years.
That's cool. That's one of my favorite stories I've read in football history.
I can't believe I shared that with people. I waited years later to say it. And if we'd have lost that Super Bowl and they found it out,
I would have brought it up.
But unfortunately, we won.
Yes, sir. So last question, and we'll let you go after this. The draft is tomorrow. First, where are you watching the draft, and who do you think the Cowboys take?
Well, I hope, and I work with guys, and I saw them at the combine. When you want to build something great, it's very difficult to continue trying to fill holes and patch holes. So I'm hoping the Cowboys say, let's make one unit great. And we don't have Dez Bryant anymore. He's no longer here. So I'm hoping they go get somebody to at least help fill that void that Dez Bryant just left. And we make a great offense, and then we continue to add and build and build on a defense. If you got an offense that's putting up 28, 30 points a game, the defense just got to rally to the ball and bring people down, you got a chance at doing some things. So hopefully a Calvin Ridley can fall to the Dallas Cowboys, and then they can put a Ridley with Ezekiel Elliott and a Dak Prescott, and then we can get back to winning them Super Bowls like we did.
Yes,
in the day. That's what I'm hoping now. And I want to say this too, though. Let me tell you what I'm most blessed about. I love that the NFL has taken the draft on the road. I do a Playmakers Academy every year, man, and I was calling some of my kids since I worked for the NFL. I've been working for 30 years for the NFL. Life expectancy is 3 years. I times 10 it. Well, thank you, God. I ain't do nothing early.
Get it out of the hole.
But I was calling some of my kids and inviting them to the draft with me. And man, you should have seen these 15, 14, 12, 13, 16-year-old kids. And we were, who's a really good draft with you? They were so excited. You know, I've been doing it for a while, you know, and watching it in New York. To get a chance to put this on the road and get a chance to let those kids see this whole process, it will inspire them because they want to be a part of it just that much more to go do great things. So I'm so thankful that we're having it here. And one last thing, I hope the ether holds true. The ether gave it to Philly last year. The draft started off in Philly. The season started with the draft, and the season ended with the parade for Philly on the Super Bowl.
If the ether does what it's supposed to do, don't trip this time. Don't start in Dallas, and we'll end the Super Bowl parade right here in Dallas.
Hey, man, they're giving up for the play, Megan. So much. I'm pretty sure everybody's here is just excited and thrilled to have you, just as I am. Appreciate the answers. Keep doing your thing.
Thank you.
If Michael Jackson performing, skip out and go watch Michael Jackson. Get that in your life. But man, we just want to thank you. Please give it up and a round of applause for the playmaker, Michael.